On the line with us, Professor Richard Wolff, the economist, co-founder of Democracy at Work, author most recently of Capitalism's Crisis Deepens, Essays on the Global Economic Meltdown, democracyatwork.info and rdwolff.com are the websites. You can tweet him at democracy at work, W-R-K, or at Prof. Wolff, W-O-L-F-F. And Professor Wolff, I saw a promo. We've got Free Speech TV now on Sling, and Louise and I have Sling. And so we popped it up, and there was a promo of you for a show that you're doing on Free Speech TV. Tell us about that.
Well, we've been doing this for a few years. It's a weekly program devoted to kind of looking what has happened in the last week that merits some attention because of its importance, particularly in terms of economics. It's both the U.S., it's global. And it's a kind of critical perspective that you won't see in the mainstream media. And it's a way for people to keep up with the economic changes that, at least in our view, are the most important to keep track of.
That's great. That's absolutely great. Now, I noticed that the Fed has proposed changing the Volcker Rule. And I've got a couple of questions around this. Number one, for people who don't know what the Volcker Rule was, can you recap that, the essence of it? Number two, I thought that the Volcker Rule was part of a legislative process. I thought it was part of Dodd-Frank, and therefore it wouldn't be the Fed making those decisions. It would be a regulatory agency, unless the Fed is taking that role. So I'm not sure how that works. And then, of course, the third question, the larger question, what will this mean for all of us? What does this mean to the American economy?
Okay, let's go through basically what the Volcker Rule is about. The crash back in 1929 was widely believed to have involved a basic maneuver of banks. And here's what I mean by maneuver. They accept deposits, both of individuals, that commercial banks do, of individuals and of companies. And they're supposed to be safekeepers. You put your money in the bank because it's holding it for you. It is acting in your interest to hold your money for you. And at the very least, it has to be very sure, so the understanding went, not to take risks with your money. It isn't their money. What the banks did before 1929 was basically interpret this understanding in a way most profitable to them, leading them to make risky investments in corporations and projects with the depositors' money. And when the crash came in 1929 and we went through the Great Depression of the 1930s, one of the results was a banking act, it was called, that specifically placed a wall between commercial banks and investment banks.
This is Glass-Steagall.
That's right. Named after the two legislators who pushed it through Congress. That's right. And the law basically said you can't use depositors' money for risky investments. If you want to make risky investments, you as a bank have to go out and solicit investors to give you money for that purpose. That's called an investment bank. You can't function as a commercial bank taking risky bets with other people's money, namely the individuals and businesses. Glass-Steagall existed, but from the very beginning, banks went to work to evade it. They made a lot of profits by using the depositors' money. Remember, then as now, they don't pay you very much for your deposit. Sometimes they pay you nothing or very low, and then they can make big returns if they invest and if it works out. So the banks wanted to be able to do that. They evaded Glass-Steagall, they watered it down, and then finally in the 1990s, under Clinton as president, they repealed it, led by the biggest banks in the country who were desperate to do that. Literally, 6 or 7 years after they did that, we had the next great crash, 2008. Out of that came the Volcker Rule, the Dodd-Frank, and a variety of steps taken to reinstitute the Glass-Steagall idea, namely that banks cannot use depositors' money for risky bets. Mr. Volcker, the former head of the Federal Reserve, took the lead in pushing for this, because he could see, as everybody else who pays attention could, that this was a terribly dangerous procedure. No sooner did he get it through over the opposition of the big banks than they went to work, lobbying, public relations, buying politicians, all the rest, to once again evade it, water it down, or if they can, get rid of it. Where we are right now is they're about to water it down. They're about to get the Federal Reserve and Congress and Mr. Trump, who's already on board for all of these things, to let them be freer than they were supposed to be now in the light of two major crashes, to let them once again do various kinds of dangerous investments with less overview, less oversight than was intended after the 2008 crash. If I might, Tom, you know, a comment here that oughtn't to be necessary but is. Our capitalist system has this peculiar, really irrational business. Banks, like other companies, abuse their positions of power and wealth. When they do it too much and we have a crash, we impose regulations. But we allow them to keep on making money, and we allow them to use the profits they get to undo the very regulations. Sooner or later, they succeed. And then again, abuses start. And then again, we re-regulate them. This is an absurd drama, very dangerous for society. Lots of victims, as the two great depressions of the last 100 years have taught us. But we don't seem to be willing or able to face this repeated kind of craziness by making the sorts of changes that ought to have been made the first time, certainly the second time, but instead we seem to be heading for yet a third time.
Yeah. So how would you expect this to play out if this watering down, well, first of all, is this the effort to water this down, this is successful now, right? Or is this just a Fed proposal?
All the signs indicate that this is now going to go through. It is not a complete getting rid of the Volcker Rule. It's basically, if you read the fine print, it means that where before banks couldn't take these kinds of risky steps, if they dared to do it and were caught doing it, they would suffer penalties, exposure, and so on. What this new adjustment is the banks are free to do what they want. The burden is now on the government, the Federal Reserve and other branches of government, to find that they're doing it, catch them at doing that, prove that they're doing it. So it puts the burden of holding them back from these dangerous speculations and risky investments. It puts the burden on the government, not on them, the way Volcker had originally intended. And remember, Volcker was a widely respected head of the Federal Reserve, somebody who had been a banker all his life. Even he could see what they are now watering down. And so my feeling is we're just going to do it all again. That's why I went over the history. We're going to now see banks desperate to make more investments that are more profitable than what they can do in the difficult economy we face. And so they're going to use this freedom that they've been fighting like crazy for in order to make those investments. And we're going to face risky, dangerous investments. And that is going to likely do what it has done over and over again, namely bring us into another economic crisis where yet another Mr. Volcker, by a different name, of course, will stand up and tell us again what Mr. Volcker already told us after the last crash, et cetera,
right,
et
which
cetera.
Is, you can't
it's
trust the banksters.
It's a pathetic display. It really is.
Yeah. And how quickly do you think, I mean, by the way, this is following on the, you said, you know, the banks are having, you know, a difficult environment. The big six banks just reported the largest quarterly profit in the history of world banking.
Absolutely. They've been doing real well, partly because they have found their ways around the few limited controls that Dodd-Frank, et cetera, put on them, and partly they were major beneficiaries of the tax cut last December.
Right. So how quickly might this play out? I mean, if this is setting up the possibility of the next great 1929-style, 2007-style crash, when would we know? When would we see the early warning signs? What would it look like?
Well, I wish I could answer that question, but here's the truth. Nobody can. Nobody knows exactly how and when. Too many variables are involved here. I will tell you this. Since the history of capitalism becoming a major economy in England and then spreading over the world, roughly 300 years, we have had an economic downturn every 4 to 7 years on average. The last big downturn was 2009 by most calculations. So if you add 4 to 7 years, the answer is we're already overdue for a downturn. Anything, the crisis in Italy, the inability of countries like Turkey and Argentina to pay back the loans they took out at the low interest rates of the last several years, any of these things that are currently agitating the world economy, and I won't even mention Mr. Trump's on-again, off-again threats to world trade, any of these things, if they get underway, will be magnified by the risky bets made by our banks.